Dr. Gowher Rizvi is one of the most senior cabinet ministers in the Bangladeshi government. The former Oxford University lecturer has been international affairs advisor to the Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina for 10 years. He's defended Bangladesh's recent elections amidst widespread accusations of voting irregularities. I'm Shamim Chowdhury and I spoke to Dr. Gowher Rizvi one-on-one.
It's not about the opinion of outside people. They are not the voters.
Election commission is totally free, independent, no doubt about it.
If there is any list of those who are missing, I can assure you, I can give you my word, that the government will conduct a full investigation.
People are being killed, people are being arrested, unprecedented.
Whatever may be the deficiency of Bangladesh media, freedom of expression is not one of them.
Dr. Rizvi, I'd like to start with the recent elections that took place in Bangladesh on the 30th of December. Dozens of people, at least more than a dozen people, were killed on that day. There have been widespread allegations of vote rigging, ballot stuffing, voter harassment, intimidation. It's a very long list. These elections were not free and fair.
Absolutely not. They were very, very fair and very, very well-managed election. You said a large number of people have complained or raised these objections, but these allegations have been all examined by the Election Commission. There were between 17 or 19 polling stations where there had been some irregularities. The Chief Election Commissioner immediately stopped the voting there, and a re-voting was done subsequently. So to claim that it was a rigged election is not borne out by the facts. That is important. I think it is very important that whatever we say is backed by evidence, and there is no evidence whatsoever.
Well, actually, there were foreign journalists, there were numerous journalists, media organizations from within Bangladesh themselves who were eyewitnesses to ballot boxes being stuffed. And there is eyewitness documentation, there is video that suggests that there was heavy rigging. So there is evidence, and many candidates have filed petitions through the legal system in Bangladesh making these claims, and they say they have the evidence to back it up.
Actually, if you are going to suggest the evidence of some journalists, we also had a very large number of national and international observers who actually observed the election process. And you were present when they presented their report of their experience of the election. You saw it yourself in Dhaka, and you heard what a glowing report. One of the observers said it was of a world-class standard, and that was the view echoed by many others. And one instance of where you talked about a footage, which was from BBC, and it was later found out that that footage was an old footage which did not apply to the current election. I am not saying by any definition that it was 100% free and fair election. Nobody says that. But on the whole, it was a free and fair election, and the outcome of the election reflected the public preference. And earlier you also mentioned about killing. You know, killing, whether it is one or two or many, is deplorable. It is unacceptable. But then you know the region as well as anybody does. During elections in Pakistan, in Bangladesh, in India, unfortunately, people do get, because passions run very, very high. But if you take the figure of 12, and compare it to what happens next door in India, you will find that this was a small figure. But just because it was a small figure, I do not mean to be callous and say it is acceptable. No, it is not acceptable.
Well, just going back to the point you made about election observers, I spoke to a number of election observers when I was in Bangladesh covering the elections. I directly asked them, do you believe these elections were free and fair? There was an uncomfortable pause, there was an uncomfortable silence. They hesitated and they said, no, we don't really. So those very observers that were there to ensure that the elections would be unfair, they themselves have denied that that was the case. And you will be aware, subsequent to the elections, some observers have come out and said they regret taking part.
If somebody in private said things differently, I don't know whether we should take that to be the reality or what they publicly stated and what they said in their written observation of the elections. Yes, there was a report in the New York Times about where they said some of the observers had changed their stories. But when New York Times correspondent went back to them, they denied that they had moved away. So there was for a moment, some people reported that they have said differently. But when New York Times correspondent went back to them, they denied having changed their stories. So I think, yes, there might have been an odd observer who saw something which he or she was not comfortable with. But I think overall, the impression of the observers was very satisfactory. And without an exception, every observer group was very positive.
Why is it then that the US, the EU, the UN, Transparency International, major organisations representing many bodies and countries around the world, all of them have called for an investigation into election irregularities?
Elections at the end of the day is not about the opinion of outside people. They are not the voters. It is the voters who matter. Our voters voted without any impediment, without any threat or coercion, in an atmosphere which observers described as a sort of a celebratory atmosphere, and they voted. And in the end, if you compare the outcome, the results of the election, with the various polls, independent polls that had been conducted prior to the election, you will notice the results were not far different from what had been already predicted. So if the election produces an outcome which is reflective of the popular preference, I don't see how outside people who have no vote, who have no say in this matter, should express an opinion.
So you're telling me that the EU, the US, Transparency International, the United Nations, these aren't just unknown outside bodies. These are the major organisations in the world. You are telling me that they have absolutely no grounds to be concerned.
I have not said that, and I am not saying that. All I am saying is, election is a domestic affair. So why is it when our people are satisfied with the election, our people have accepted the results of the election, we are putting extraordinary amount of weight. And what they have said is this, they have reports, they said, that there have been some irregularities and there should be an investigation. And as I said, the Chief Election Commissioner has investigated them. And that is the due process. What more can be done?
Well, the opposition parties are saying that the Election Commission itself is politically biased because they were calling for the head of the Election Commission to stand down because of his allegiances to the Awami League, the fact that he's not partisan. If that proves to be the case, then it raises huge questions about the impartiality of the Election Commission and the decisions that
first,
it makes.
First, let us... look at this argument about the allegiance of the Chief Election Commission towards the Awami League. Would you have any evidence to that? I can make many claims. Just because a claim has been made and for a journalist to accept that claim doesn't befit a neutral investigative journalist.
I'm not necessarily accepting the claim. I'm just saying that this is the opposition party.
If they have not given you the evidence, I think even repeating the claim is a mistake.
Keeping along the discussion on opposition groups and their criticisms, one of their accusations has been that not just in the lead up to election time, but over the past few years or so, that the government is responsible for abducting many of their senior leaders, many senior members, silencing opposition. The Rapid Action Battalion, the elite police force, has been accused not just by opposition groups, but also by local human rights organisations, as well as Human Rights Watch, that it's been carrying out extrajudicial killings and that the government itself is behind this systematic silencing, illegal silencing of opposition leaders. And by doing that, it has crushed opposition parties. Some of those orders, some of these accusations, that it's come directly from the Prime Minister.
These are allegations. These are unsubstantiated allegations. A claim was made by the Secretary General of Bangladesh National Party that 125,000 party workers of and supporters of BNP had been arrested by the government. The Prime Minister immediately said, give us a list and we will have each of them investigated. Shortly afterwards, Fakhrul Alamgir did give us a list, and the list was of one list was of 1,500 and one was of 1,000. I'm not saying these are small numbers, but where is 125,000 and where is 2,500?
It's still a very large number.
Still, I did say that. I'm not. Second thing is, were these people actually arrested because they belong to a particular party? No. You will recall that in 2015, there had been massive movement conducted by Jamaat and BNP of arson, burning, looting, killing. Over 100 people were killed during this thing. At that time, the police had initiated cases. Warrants had been issued in 2015 against these people. Many of them disappeared, went abroad, hid themselves. Police arrested them in 2018 because they resurfaced, not because they were. That said, I will not deny altogether.
Many are still missing.
If people are missing, if there is any list of those who are missing, I can assure you, I can give you my word that the government will conduct a full investigation.
It's been a very long time, though.
And
this
final
has been
point,
going on for a long time.
And the final point. You must remember that the government has authority, judicial and legal power, to arrest and detain people. Why would a government want to disappear somebody when it can legally arrest a person?
Well, one of the accusations is that these people have been arrested without warrants. They're literally being taken away.
Well, okay, again, without knowing the exact case, it would be arrogant of me to deny that.
But I do want to move on, and I want to talk about Bangladesh's economy. There is no denying, regardless of what people may suspect about the governance of Bangladesh, that the country is doing phenomenally well. Nearly 7% growth over the past decade or so. Life expectancy is higher than Pakistan and India. It is surely very, very, the statistics are extremely impressive. Now, in your election manifesto, you have promised 9% growth. How is Bangladesh going to achieve that?
Before I comment on that, let me say to you one thing. You prefaced this question by saying that irrespective of the governance. May I tell you that without governance, without good policies, you cannot achieve the economic miracle, economic and social miracle that Bangladesh has. To say that government is irrelevant comes from...
No, it's not irrelevant.
No. So I think it is important to recognize and give the credit to the government where it is due.
Absolutely. Okay. I agree with you.
And thank you for saying all these nice things about our economic and social achievement. The reason we are confident...
Well, the statistics are there.
Reason that we are confident, not only of 9%, I would say we can achieve double-digit growth because we have certain policies and certain measures in place. We have invested heavily in transport and power infrastructure. One of the things that was holding back Bangladesh's growth was lack of power. Today, in the last 5 years or 7 years, the government has built 15,000 megawatts of electricity and another 6,000 is in the pipeline, which means for the first time, Bangladesh is able to meet the full power requirement of the industries, and that is what is projected. Similarly, we are building new roads, new ports, investing heavily in railway to improve the transport infrastructure. Together with that, we have invested in human resources to improve productivity. This is a beginning, but as we work our way towards 2030 agenda, where investment in human capital has been one of the most important things, I believe combination of investment in human capital, infrastructure, transport and power building, and good governance will ensure not only 7-9, but easily double-digit growth. And that is why the investors from all around the world now have Bangladesh. And the difficulty with us has been Bangladesh has for a long time been mired in a negative narrative. And as that negative narrative makes room for a progressive, buoyant, effective, fast-growing economy, the investors will now come in for which we have long awaited.
There are also widespread accusations that the current government has massively curbed freedom of speech, freedom of expression, the media has been curbed. The example that springs to mind is that of Shahid Al-Alam, the interview that he gave to an international broadcaster, which I have watched. As a result of that, and because he was taking pictures at a recent student demonstration, he was detained, arrested and detained for a considerable length of time. He said he was tortured. Amnesty International said he was tortured while he was kept in detention. This reflects very, very poorly on Bangladesh's track record of a lack of freedom of expression in its country.
Let me question some of your premises. You started by saying freedom of expression, media, newspapers are curbed. There are 450 plus daily newspapers in Bangladesh. In the last 10 years, how many newspapers have been barred by the government? If you look at it, there's going to be only one newspaper. And that was barred not for its political reason, but it was inciting sectarian violence. Not a single newspaper has been barred. And anybody who goes to Bangladesh, reads the newspaper, will know that whatever may be the deficiency of Bangladesh media, freedom of expression is not one of them.
Whatever you are saying, the Shahid Al-Alam
I'm coming case. To that. I'll come to that. Second thing, you talked about the Digital Act. There, you see, digital media developed without any regulation, without control. Print media is controlled by law. There are laws controlling it and supporting it. There was no such regulations there.
But it's still very vague. But it's still very broad. That is dangerous.
It may not be ideally. There may be some defects in it, and I will be the first to admit there may be. And that is why the government will look at it, will talk to the editors, get their views, and amend it. We have often done this. We have passed an act, and as it has been tried, when it has been found, where the shoe pinches, we change the law. It is not written in perpetuity, so there is no reason to believe government is susceptible to popular opinion, and it will have to take that into account. Last point about Shahid. And this is personally for me a painful thing to talk about, because I count Shahid as a friend. All I want to say to you is, this is something that is still under investigation. But I do want to correct you by saying that he was not arrested for speaking to Al Jazeera. The charge against him, and which will either stand up in the court or fail, is that he was spreading disinformation during the student movement, which could have endangered lives. And government has a responsibility.
And you believe there's evidence to that effect?
As I said, it is in the court. This is the charge against him. Charge against him is not he spoke to Al Jazeera. It is disinformation. And for me to say one way or the other would be to prejudice the case and would be disrespectful to a person whom I consider as my friend.
That doesn't really explain why he said he was limping when he was released. There's footage of him limping. That doesn't explain his claims that he was tortured while he was detained.
Again, I take your word. I would ask Amnesty International, which made this statement, as you just said, would they share what evidence they have before making that statement?
Well, he said it himself and he was limping, so there must be medical evidence, one would assume.
As I said, I would not want to comment on this, partly because of my personal relationship with the man whom I am fond of, deeply respect, with whom I have worked and will continue, I hope, to work. So in those circumstances, it would be, if you push me this question, I will have to say no or yes. In either way, I would be guessing and I would be wrong.
Dr. Rizvi, we are going to have to end it soon. I just want to ask you about the Rohingya refugee crisis. Bangladesh now has more than 1 million Rohingya refugee living in camps in the southern part of the country. The country has been credited for giving them home and shelter. But the policy remains repatriation. And it doesn't seem as though Bangladesh has made any progress on that issue, primarily because Myanmar has not really given satisfactory explanation as to their safety when they return, satisfactory assurances, I should say, about their safety when they return. And in particular, very little has been said about reinstating their citizenship, which was stripped in 1982. What kind of pressure can Bangladesh put on Myanmar to ensure that this happens?
Actually, you have already answered your own question. To the extent that what Bangladesh can do, it has done. It has provided basic but safe shelter of 1 million people. No other country in the world, let alone a country of Bangladesh's economic conditions, could even contemplate doing it. Not only we have taken these refugees, we have also made it extremely clear that we will not do forcible repatriation. It will be voluntary repatriation when it happens. But for this to happen, the problem is not in Bangladesh, it is in Myanmar. It is not just for Bangladesh, but it is for the entire world. What we are seeing in Myanmar today is a very, very dangerous thing, where a government has systematically committed genocide and ethnic cleansing to remove an entire ethnic group from its soil. Now, the world cannot stand back and watch this, because if Myanmar succeeds, this will be literally, it would let loose forces all over the world, and minorities nowhere in the world will be safe. Therefore, it is incumbent on us, for the whole world, global community, to put pressure, economic embargo, military embargoes, travel restriction, trade restrictions, investment restrictions, so that the military regime in Myanmar wakes up and starts behaving like a civilized member of the international community.
Dr. Rizvi, it's highly unlikely that's going to happen, realistically. It has China and it's on its side. China is a member, permanent member of the Security Council at the United Nations. It will veto any kind of pressure, the list that you've just given me, is proposed.
So same
Bangladesh
argument,
has
same
to accept
argument,
that these refugees will be in Bangladesh for decades to come.
The same argument was used in the case of South Africa, that you cannot bring economic sanctions against South Africa to dismantle apartheid. When the global community united, it did, and apartheid went. Yes, I'm not saying it will happen tomorrow. And United Nations is not the only body which is curbed by its veto power. There is an international community. International opinion does matter. And the list that I have suggested does not require a global action. United, individual countries can take these actions and make it happen.
Dr. Rizvi, thank you very much for speaking to TRT World.
Thank you, Shamim.